quite a bit of time this week we're going to spend in an enrichment activity. What we're going to look at is how matrix-matrix multiplication can achieve extremely high performance on a typical processor. Some of you have noticed that when we discuss the cost of operations, we talk about memory operations, and we never really spend enough time on what that means. The reason for this is that the best place to discuss the cost of memory operations and how this can be overcome is when we reach matrix-matrix multiplication, which is where we are now. What we're going to see is that the vector-vector operations that you learned about in week one, namely AXP and DOT, can inherently not achieve high performance. The reason for this is that they require too many memory operations for the number of floating point operations that you perform. Similarly, the matrix vector operations, matrix vector multiplication and rank one update, cannot achieve high performance either. Again, the reason is that the number of memory operations that you perform is just not favorable. This problem can be overcome when you start looking at matrix-matrix multiplication. In order to talk about the cost of memory operations and how this affects performance, we're going to have to look just a little bit at computer architecture. But not to worry, I'll keep it very, very simple. So we're going to talk about slicing and dicing for performance. And this is what I do. This is what I do for my research. It's all about attaining high performance. And what we're going to see is that matrix-matrix multiplication is the key. Let's have a look at a processor, but we're going to look at a very, very simple processor. Obviously, you would have to take a course in architecture to fully understand this subject, but you're going to find out you don't need to understand very much. What you do need to understand is that there is this thing called a processor, and you may have seen a picture of a computer chip. So imagine the processor being one of those chips, and the important components of that chip are the central processing unit, which is where the computation happens. And for us, a very important part of the central processing unit is the floating point unit. This is where floating point computations happen. Remember, real numbers can't be stored, so we store something called floating point numbers. And when we perform computation with floating point numbers, we do so in the floating point unit. Now, a processor may have more than one floating point unit, but that's none of our concern. What is our concern is the fact that in order to do computation, you have to have data in registers. And there are very few registers. There may be 16, there may be 64. The bottom line is it's a limited resource. Now, typically, your data is actually in main memory. So somehow that data has to come from main memory into the register in order to perform computation. Now, also on the chip, you'll find a little bit of very fast memory. Now, memory takes space. A chip is very small, and therefore we can only afford to have a relatively small amount of this very fast memory. Typically, this is on the order of, say, 16 kilobytes or 32 kilobytes. When data is in the level 1 cache, one can access that data fast enough to keep a typical floating point unit happy. The instant you're dealing with more data, you're going to have to store that somewhere else. And the data is going to have to reside either in something called an L2 cache, which is off-chip, but still relatively fast, or in main memory, which is much farther away, and you may be able to perform as many as 100 floating point operations in the time it takes to bring data from main memory into a register. So you want to compute with data that's close by, preferably in the level 1 cache. So it's all about where you store data. And to explain how to exploit all of these different kinds of memory, we draw this pyramid that represents the hierarchical memories. What do we have? At the top, we have a few registers. Below it, we have the L1 cache, which is on chip and very fast. Below that, we have the L2 cache, which is off chip, a little bit slower. And then we have main memory below that. So the idea is that the registers are really fast. Main memory is extremely slow. But you only have a few of those very fast registers, and you have a very large amount of main memory. Let's move the labels to the side, and let's look at a couple of operations. So here we look at the dot product. And the problem is that inherently, if the vectors are in main memory, then you have to bring those vectors into registers. And therefore, it requires two n memory operations if n is the size of the vectors. Why? Because you have to read each of the elements of x and each of the elements of y. The scalar alpha is less of a concern because the scalar alpha we can place in a register while the entire operation happens. That's why we typically ignore the cost of bringing alpha in from memory, because it's really bringing in those vectors that is our main concern. What about the AXP? Well, there we have exactly the same problem. We're now performing three n memory operations because we have to read the vector x, read the vector y, and then write out the vector y. And if each of those is of size n, then we perform three n memory operations. Now, with each pair of elements in x and y, we perform a multiply and an add. So we perform two n floating point operations. And again, the good news is that we can take our alpha and place it in a register during the entire computation, so we don't need to worry too much about the cost of bringing it in from main memory. What about our matrix vector operations, matrix vector multiplication? We have to assume that the matrix and the vectors are initially in main memory. Now notice that we inherently have to perform n squared memory operations. Why is that? Well, every entry of the matrix must be read. And here we're going to assume that the matrix is squared just for convenience sake. Now, with each element in the matrix, we perform two floating point operations, a multiply and an add. So we perform two n squared floating point operations for n squared memory operations. We don't have to be quite as concerned about the cost of bringing the vectors in, because we can keep one vector, for example, x, in one of the caches, and then we end up performing, in this case, dot products with that vector, which means that we can take an element of y and actually place it in a register while the dot product happens. So the cost of bringing those vectors in and out of memory is not that big of a concern. But imagine if it costs 100 times more to bring an element in from main memory than it costs to actually perform a floating point operation with it, then you can imagine that bringing the data in from main memory is the real bottleneck. Similarly, the rank one update is an extremely important operation. What about that operation? Well, here we have to bring each element of C, the green box, in from main memory, and then write it back out once it has been updated. So in this case, we perform two n squared memory operations for two n squared floating point operations. So the ratio is 1:1. That's even worse than the matrix vector multiply. Again, we don't have to be quite as concerned about the vectors, because we can bring those into the L1 cache and keep them there, and or we can place an element in a register and reuse that many, many times. So let's move on to matrix-matrix multiplication. Well, here we're dealing with three matrices. Let's assume that they are square, n by n. Inherently, we have to read each of the matrices, A, B, and C, the green, the red, and the blue. And we have to write the green box back out, C. So we perform at least four n squared memory operations. But for those four n squared memory operations, we perform two n cubed floating point operations. So now all of a sudden, in theory, we end up being able to perform n floating point operations for every two memory operations, and therefore there's an opportunity for moving data in and out of the caches and getting lots of data reuse out of that. Ideally, we would simply take the matrices, move them into the cache, and then compute with them. But what this picture also shows is that it's highly likely that the cache is just not that big. If the L1 cache is 32 kilobytes, then one can roughly store 340 by 40 matrices in the L1 cache, and typically our matrices are much larger than that. So what to do about that? Well, notice that we have learned how to do a partitioned matrix-matrix multiplication, and therefore what we can do is partition the matrices, move blocks into the L1 cache that fit in the L1 cache, perform matrix-matrix multiplication, perform a matrix-matrix multiplication with the next blocks of A and B, and finally write the block of C back out. So if each block is B by B, then you end up doing 4B squared memory operations for every 2B cubed floating point operations, and if B is large enough, then that ratio is quite favorable. It turns out that blocking into squares like this is suboptimal, and I'm going to talk about that in further enrichment videos. Now, what's the impact on performance? Here we have a graph. Now, unfortunately, you can't see this graph all that well, but be patient. Along the x-axis, we plot the size of the matrix. So if each of the matrix is n by n, then the size of the matrix is plotted along the x-axis, and it ranges from 0 by 0 to 1,000 by 1,000. Along the y-axis, we plot gigaflops per second. Now, what is a gigaflop? A gigaflop represents a billion floating point operations. So a gigaflop per second is a billion floating point operations per second being performed by the processor. Now, what's important is in this particular graph is that the top of the graph represents 100% utilization. So you want to be as close to the top of the graph as possible. And if you simply write a very simple triple nested loop in a higher performing language like C, then you get performance represented by the green, by the blue line. This actually is performance that I measured on my own laptop. And notice that it's very pathetic. Where does this initial bump come from? Well, that comes from the matrices being small enough that they fit in the L2 cache, and therefore you have faster access to them. Eventually, the problem size becomes large enough that the matrices have to reside in main memory, and then the performance gets a whole lot worse. If, on the other hand, you very carefully partition your matrices and you very carefully orchestrate your computation by partitioning or blocking, then you get much better performance. This red line is what I managed to achieve, and notice that I'm getting something like 90% of peak. There's a huge difference. My estimate is that the blue line eventually is achieving maybe 2 or 3% of the peak performance, and the red line eventually, for very large problems, achieves better than 90%. So the difference is huge. Now, the techniques for achieving that are actually relatively simple. And what I have done is I've put together a wiki that marches you through this. Unfortunately, you need to know the C programming language, or C++, in order to fully understand what's going on. But even if you don't know how to program, I believe you will get something out of at least looking at the wiki. And be warned that this goes beyond this course, obviously, and we're very busy with the course itself. So if you choose to actually go and follow the exercise in this particular wiki page, you're mostly on your own, or you're going to have to discuss it with others on the discussion boards.